music of life seems to be like a bell that's ringing for me. From the way that I feel when that bell starts to peal, it's almost like falling. I swear I was falling. It's almost like being alone.
Joseph Arkfeld Trio for our wonderful music this morning. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Okay, we're going to do it one more time. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
On this glorious day in God's kingdom, this 20th Sunday after the Feast of Pentecost, when we truly could not have asked for a more spectacular time and setting to worship our Lord. A special welcome to anyone who is watching with us, worshiping with us on Facebook. We are so glad that even though you can't be here with us physically, you are here with us in spirit, worshiping together. Please sit back, relax, and now enjoy our opening hymn, and then I will ask us to stand as the liturgy continues.
Others' ways, where love is lived and all.
invite those who are present to stand as you are able as our service continues on page 2 of our worship bulletin. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever.
I invite you to join me in praying together. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Created each one of us in your own image. Assist your people to give to earthly rulers and powers what belongs to them, and to give our allegiance and ourselves to you alone, the one whose image is imprinted on every human soul. Through Jesus Christ, our liberator, who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
We continue now with our psalm reading. Join me in reciting a portion of Psalm 96 responsively by whole verse. Sing to God a new song. Sing to God, all the whole earth.
Sing and bless God's holy name. Proclaim the good news of salvation from day to day.
Declare God's glory among the nations, God's wonders among all peoples.
For God is great and greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols. But it is God who made the heavens.
Oh, the majesty and magnificence of God's presence. Oh, the power and splendor of God's sanctuary.
Ascribe to God, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to God honor and power.
Ascribe due honor to God's holy name. Bring offerings and come into God's courts.
Worship the Most High in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth tremble before God.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you, because our message of the gospel came to you, not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. Just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Spirits long to be made whole.
Will you please stand for the reading of the gospel? The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this? And whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hard wood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your spirit, that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you. For the honor of your name, amen. Please be seated. As we prepared for our wedding, my husband and I talked, in principle at least, about many of the important decisions that would shape the contours of our marriage. We loved each other very much, and we knew that we wanted to spend our lives together. But as anyone who has ever been in a long-term relationship knows, that desire alone was not enough. We needed to be intentional about thinking some decisions through ahead of time, to the best of our ability, without the benefit of a crystal ball. How would we handle money? Where would we live? This is my favorite. How would we fight? And what about children? Those conversations were essential. And all these years later, Randy and I still refer back to them whenever we find ourselves at an inflection point, a turning point in our relationship. I am grateful that in its wisdom, the Episcopal Church requires that couples seeking marriage enter into premarital counseling first, so as to have the opportunity to consider a whole gamut of potential issues before they become issues. No counselor can cover every scenario, of course. And unfortunately, nowhere in our premarital sessions did we discuss one topic that has become a pretty big bone of contention for Randy and me. Dogs. Do you see what I did there? Bone of contention? Dogs? Oh, anyway, I'm kind of keeping people awake this morning. All right. It turns out that Randy and I probably should have talked about dogs before we walked down the aisle, because we wound up entering our union having no idea about our fundamentally different points of view where dogs were concerned. As you may know, I am an only child, and so growing up, my pets, my dogs, my cats, my many, many gerbils, my fish, these were my constant companions. Our dogs in particular were the siblings I never had. And in our house, they were treated like royalty. You know how some mothers run down the whole list of their children's names before they get the right one? You know, William, Peter, and Yeah, if I always came after Pepper, the Cocker Spaniel. True story. Randy, on the other hand, was raised on a farm in the South. And while he did have both a dog and a cat growing up, they stayed outside in the woodshed. And they occupied a very different place in the family pecking order. You see where I'm going, I'm sure. Fast forward a few years. And by this point, my husband and I had just two little boys, ages 4 and 2. Andrew had not been born yet. After a lot of conversation and coaxing, I convinced Randy that our family was still not complete and that we needed to adopt a dog. Randy was not at all sure about this initially, but he knew how much it meant to me, and he agreed that it probably would be good for the boys. So he relented. But adopting a dog turned out to be far more complicated than I had even imagined. We had to submit voluminous paperwork, gather references, and undergo quite a lot of scrutiny before we could take a dog home. It was in no means a guarantee. After several weeks of searching without success, we had become fairly discouraged. In fact, we were just about ready to give up because it didn't seem fair to the boys to keep getting their hopes up. We decided to go to just one more adoption event. And if it didn't work out, we would resign ourselves to the fact that it wasn't meant to be. Of course, that's when we met her, a quiet, timid, very thin, very dirty young dog with liquid brown eyes who came up to us sniffing gingerly at our shoes. As improbable as it seemed, we all lost our hearts in that moment. And so, in an hour's time or so, Megan was loaded into the front seat of our minivan, and we headed off to Petco for supplies. An hour and hundreds of dollars later, we took our little girl home. I assumed that the hard part was behind us and that now all was left to do was simply enjoy one another. Silly me. Those first few days with Megan turned out to be a real trial. Initially, she skulked leerily around the perimeter of every room in our house, never making eye contact, and scurrying behind furniture at any initiation of affection. She didn't bark. In fact, it would be weeks before we discovered that she howled like a full-throated beagle with her head thrown back. It's probably just as well we didn't know that back in the day. The only noise she made was to growl menacingly every time our then 2-year-old, Peter, approached her. Needless to say, this scared us a lot. And with a lot of prayer and not a few tears, we decided that Megan just had to go back. It seemed too dangerous to keep her in a family with children. And we knew we had to move quickly before the boys became too attached. Having been the one to initiate the adoption, it was now my job, of course, to contact the rescue agency. I dreaded that call, but I screwed up my courage and I dialed. And I'll never forget the conversation with Nancy, the adoption coordinator. When I told her our plight, Nancy responded wisely and hopefully. These things take time, she counseled. And if only we were willing to risk giving Megan a little more love, She suspected that things would turn around. "Okay," I said, hanging up the phone tentatively. "If this doesn't work out, I will be the one in the doghouse." And the rest, as they say, is history. After several more weeks of misadventures, including not a few chewed shoes, Megan began to settle in, and so did we. Over time, Megan trained us all how to love her, patiently, yet firmly. Over time, as we learned her rhythms and came to understand her temperament, Megan outgrew her fear, and she stopped growling. Over time, Megan and Peter became the best of friends. Over time, Megan gradually came back to life as if from suspended animation. Like a parched plant given sunshine and water, Megan began to thrive. And that's not all. Guess who else was transformed by that relationship? Yes, after the next nearly 15 years together, Megan and Randy developed the most beautiful bond. Meal by meal, walk by walk, snuggle by snuggle, she changed him. She converted him. And by the time that sweet little girl finally left us last Christmas, Randy had become an unapologetic dog person. And not just any dog person, but Megan's person, and Molly's person, and now Joey's person. That, my friends, is what love can do. I share this story this morning because it is one of the purest and most poignant examples that I have ever experienced of the transformative power of love. Once a timid stray who lashed out and growled in order to protect herself, with patience and care, Megan learned that she did not have to defend herself all the time. The world as she had known it before coming to live with us was harsh and lonely, and our guess is pretty dangerous. She was no doubt right not to trust easily or quickly. It wasn't necessarily safe to do so. But love changed that. I'm willing to bet that each of us here this morning knows people like this as well. People who, for whatever reason, have been so bruised by life that they are scared to trust or to let others in. It's just too risky. Perhaps we ourselves have been, or are now, like this too. I'll just pause there for a second as we reflect on whether we too are scared and timid and ever lash out of our fear or our shame. It's little wonder if we do. The world as we know it can be a harsh and a dangerous and a frightening place. A place in which it does not always feel safe to risk opening our hearts. Certainly, the current climate in our country has made many of us more guarded and suspicious than we once might have been. One does not need to be a psychologist to recognize the consequences of human woundedness walking around all about us. As the old maxim goes, hurt people hurt people. We tend to perpetuate our own pain, intentionally or not, and we inflict it in turn on others, unless something happens to disrupt that cycle. But is that how we really want to live? The acclaimed Anglican author C.S. Lewis, who is famous for his Narnia Chronicles, as well as other many pivotal theological texts, addressed this very question in a little book entitled The Four Loves. In it, Lewis wrote this: "To To love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything and your heart will be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give it to no one, not even an animal. Wrap it carefully round with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Lock it up safe in the casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. If we want to be sure that our hearts are not broken, we must lock them up, or they will become not only unbreakable, but impenetrable and irredeemable too. Now, as Christians, we are taught that nothing and no one is beyond redemption, beyond the reach of God's saving embrace. But at the same time, we know too well that we have the ability and often the propensity to reject God's love, to remain guarded, to hold back, to play it safe, to shy away from receiving and giving love because it is just too scary and too risky to do so. But Jesus invites us to live differently. Throughout the Gospels, he challenges his friends and foes alike to allow themselves to hear and see and know and understand in the marrow of their bones how very deeply they are loved. And so he preaches forgiveness and generosity and an abundance that seems painfully out of step with the harsh reality of the world in which he lives. The gospel of Jesus seems foolish to anyone who has learned the hard way not to trust, not to risk. Nevertheless, Jesus invites us to break out of the caskets we have constructed around our wounded hearts and take a chance to let ourselves be loved and to share that love. In the gospel reading we heard just now, Jesus tells the Pharisees and the followers of King Herod to give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. This is one of Jesus's most clever moments, I think, in all of the gospels. He asks for a coin and he says, "Whose image is on that coin?" To which the Pharisees and the Herodians say, "Caesar's." And Jesus says, "Then render to Caesar, give to Caesar what is Caesar's." But that then begs the question, when Jesus says, "Give to God, render to God what is God's," we might well ask ourselves, what is God's? If Caesar's image is on the coin, and we give that coin to the emperor, whose image is on us? Not a rhetorical question. Whose image is on us? God's. So we give to God what is God, what belongs to God, which is to say us, ourselves, our souls, our bodies, to quote one of the Eucharistic prayers in our Book of Common Prayer. We give to God everything. Understood that way, it makes paying the IRS on April 15th seem like a piece of cake, doesn't it? When we put it in that proportion. But this is life's work. It takes time and care and patience, and probably most of us will not get there this side of the grave. But that is our mission. To give our hearts and our souls to God. Giving God everything means, first and foremost, taking a risk to love. To love God, to love our neighbor, and as our presiding bishop always reminds us, to love ourselves. to break out of the caskets or the coffins we have built around our own hearts, to risk being agents of God's love in our hurting world. Jesus challenges us not to play it safe, not to hold back in a world that so desperately needs to experience and feel God's love. We all know, intellectually at least, what a difference love can make. And yet so often we do hold back out of fear or apathy or shame, or perhaps even selfishness. But do we want to remain locked behind walls in a safe, dark, motionless, airless place? Is that really how we want to live? Is that really who we want to be? My friends, love is transformative. Love changes hearts. Love changes minds. Love changes lives. That is what love can do. And this is what you and I together can do with God's help. We can love the world into wholeness, one step at a time, with patience and care. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you please stand as you are able? Our service continues now at the bottom of page 5 in your worship bulletin with the Nicene Creed. Let us say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue now with the prayers of the people.
Let us lift our hearts to God in prayer. For the church throughout the world, that the gospel may be known in every land, we pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Marianne and Chilton, our bishops, and all who minister in God's name. For the mission of the church,
We pray to you, Lord Christ.
for the leaders of our nation, that they might execute equity and justice for the good of all people. We pray especially for the President, members of Congress, justices of the Supreme Court, and all those standing for election. For the welfare of the nation, we pray to you, Lord Christ. For the whole world, that its disease and famine, war and strife, poverty and ignorance may be healed by the balm of your mercy. We remember with intention the Vivanco family, missionaries in Ecuador. For the peace of the world,
we pray to you, Lord Christ.
We pray for our towns, cities, and neighborhoods, that there might be food for the hungry, shelter for the homeless, and welcome for the stranger. For the hospitality of this community,
we pray to you, Lord Christ.
We pray for all who suffer in body, mind, or soul, remembering especially those on our parish prayer list: Donna Alman, Nancy Bancroft, Richard and Florence Banks, Sydney Betts, Phil Carroll, Bill Darnell, Kenny Farnsworth, Warren Green, Hansen, Anya Hine, Barbara Hawker, Virgie Horvath, Rick Hutchenlocker, Jason and Amy Krill and their family, Isabel Crum, Rachel McMillan, Joyce Nugent, Pam Plaisance, Kurt Shively, Allison Spaulding, Lena Verville, Pat Von Rautenkrantz, Don Wasserman, and Trudy Wood. We pray for all those impacted by COVID-19 and those affected by wildfires and hurricanes. We also remember those whom we now name silently and aloud. For the gift of healing,
we pray to you, Lord Christ.
We pray for those who have died, that their souls and the souls of all the departed may rest in peace. We remember in particular Carolyn Collins, friend of Louise Smoke, and Doreen Montalvo, and those who we name now either silently or aloud. For the lives of the saints,
we give thanks to you, Lord Christ.
For blessings so numerous we cannot count them, that we may in turn be a blessing to others. For the transformative power of love,
we give thanks to you, Lord Christ.
Thanksgiving, blessing, and praise be yours, God of the Incarnation, because you care for us and for our prayer. May our love for you and our likeness to you be strengthened every time we pray. Amen. Amen. Let us now confess our sins to God, saying together, God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, forgive you all, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. My friends, remaining where you are, I invite you to join me in sharing God's peace. May the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, my dear friends. Peace. And peace to those worshiping with us online. If you are with us online, please take a moment just to say hi in the comment box so that we know that you're there and we can include you in our prayers. I invite you, once you've exchanged the peace, to take a seat for a couple of moments of announcements. Welcome again, everyone. Look at the sun. This is glorious. Just a reminder for those who are with us in person today that, as has become our custom, if you do anything more than once in the Episcopal Church, it becomes a custom. As has become our custom, at this service, we will be celebrating the Holy Eucharist, the Lord's Supper, the Mass, Communion, and we will distribute consecrated bread, the host only. Wine will not be consumed. Congregants, you will be invited by your pods, by the ushers who will lead you forward, to follow the arrows and keeping socially distant to come down to this round table in front of the altar. There you will find the bread in individual wrappers. Please take yours. I will say the words of administration to you. Please keep your mask on. Go back up the stairs to your pod and you can consume the sacrament there. If you would prefer not to receive communion, I invite you to come forward anyway for a blessing. And you can signal to me that that's what you want simply by crossing your arms over your chest. If you are worshiping with us at home, we will offer a prayer of spiritual communion for you. I encourage you, as if you are here this morning, on your way out of worship, to stop by the check-in table and pick up a postcard, which you at some point will be receiving at home. I mailed these a long time ago, and at least it hasn't made it to my house yet. So I'm not gonna say anything about the US Postal Service, but it may take a while. Anyway, if you have been following our emails, you know that beginning tomorrow, St. Dunstan's and the Church of the Redeemer here in Bethesda will be offering joint services of morning prayer and compline. May God bless whatever situation is necessitating that siren. We will be offering daily joint services of prayer at 10 a.m. and compline at 8 p.m. The daily morning prayer will be by phone, so you don't have to get on a screen. You just dial a number, and either Cricket or I will be on the other end to pray with you. And at 8 o'clock in the evening, we will have various services of Teze compline on Monday evenings, led by our own Joey Arkfeld. There will be a Celtic compline one night. There will be other different kinds of compline. Our own Robin Reed will be leading compline on Thursday evenings. It's a wonderful way to expand the reach of both parishes by combining our forces together for prayer. And be on the lookout in today's daily email. You'll have all of the information you need in order to participate. I hope you'll give it a try. With that said, I'm going to turn the microphone now over to our own dear Sue Carroll, vestry member and stewardship guru extraordinaire, who has a special message for us today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Anybody
Good
morning. Remember this?
Yeah.
For those of you who may not know, this is my little way of indicating and demonstrating that stewardship campaign can be fun. We like to have a good time here. And this is where we are. We're launching our stewardship campaign. It's that time of year
when we look at all the gifts that we have been given, and we intentionally share a portion of those gifts, the money part of it, to support the work of Jesus Christ as it is done here on earth through the church, through our church, St. Dunstan's. Our theme this year is, what can love do? Part of the answer to that question, look around you. Love has found a way, in spite of some of the significant obstacles, to gather us together for worship and communion. Love has found a way to continue connecting us with each other, even in this time of the coronavirus, to teach and learn, nourish and guide, serve and pray together. Love has found a way to bring the party to you. Those of you here should have gift bags for each of you. And the St. Dunstan Stewardship Elves will be delivering them to the households of those we know at home. Hi, guys. We will wear our masks. We will keep good social distance. But we'll be bringing you treats and surprises in your bags. And you'll find information on how and why to make a financial pledge to support the ongoing functioning of St. Dunstan's Church. I'm happy to tell you that the pledges from your vestry members are already coming in, and the total pledged by the vestry is already way over where it was last year. So yay for the leadership here at St. Dunstan's. Stay tuned for further developments. Let us know if you have any questions. And remember that one of the things love can do is bring joy and a good laugh into your life.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much, Sue, for your loving and faithful and visionary leadership. This parish is deeply indebted to you. Are there any other announcements that need to be made for the good of the order? Hearing none, my friends, ascribe due honor to God's name, bring offerings, and come in to God's court. Invite you, as you are able, please, to stand. We continue now. All things come from you, O God.
From your own will you have given.
Apologies for that noise. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join the saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself. Yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at the table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer you these gifts of bread and wine and ourselves, a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Dunstan, and all our saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We are one body, for we all share in the one bread.
My sisters and brothers, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. For those worshiping with us at home, I invite you to join me in a prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart as though you have already come. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Here I am, Lord. Is it I? by the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will say, finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I say? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard
Let us pray at the top of page 13. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. My friends, life is short, and we haven't much time to gladden the hearts of those with whom we walk this earth. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you and all those you love from this day forth and forevermore. Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
time, the Joseph Arc Film Trio. And now, as I dismiss us to go forth from this place, and as I bid farewell to those of you who are worshiping with us online, a reminder, if you are here physically present, make sure you pick up your goodie bag from the table. If you haven't already, Karen is passing them out. Don't leave for home without it. And if you are watching us at home, if you are on our regular list, we will be delivering to you in the very soon. And if you do not receive a goodie bag at your house and would like one, you know where to find me. Please be in touch with us in the parish office, and a stewardship elf will happily make a stop at your house as well. My friends, let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thank you, God.